So many people here in Edmonton have been touched by the life of Wayne Gretzky. He made the game here. He revolutionized it. And here's some reaction to his passing from the NHL right now.
I first heard that Wayne was traded, and foolishly enough, I think I was going to, I phoned my agent, Mike Mardin, who's also Wayne's agent, and said, you know, I want to talk to Slats. I said, at least I want to put my 2 cents in. And Mike said, hold on, big guy. He said, you might be in on the trade. I think that if Wayne had a chance to get Mark Messier or Grant Fuhr or Kevin Lowe or Glenn Anderson, that he would have jumped to get those guys down there with him. But I think being a young player, a player who didn't get a lot of points, and a player that was willing to get my nose dirty, you know, and Wayne was grateful. Wayne was really grateful for the guys around him, like Dave Semenko and those guys who stood up for him. So, in essence, I think he did me a big favor, giving me a chance to go down there and expand my career.
Yeah, one of my highlights is him setting me up for my one and only hat trick, and certainly playing left wing with him on our way to our first Stanley Cup, where I played 3 full series with him, and it was a delight. It's a totally different type of hockey game when you're playing with him. Everything opens up. And I was called on to finish off a few more plays than finishing off, I guess, a few opponents.
I remember a play in the early 80s where Wayne liked to try and draw penalties, especially in the Coliseum. And there was one play in a game against Philadelphia. They were down a goal, and he was falling down a lot in that particular game, and the fans were on me pretty good. And late in the game, they were down by a goal, and their best advantage was to get a power play. And play stopped with the Philadelphia goalie freezing the puck. And Wayne was standing in the corner behind the net where he was so effective, and nobody was around him. And all of a sudden, he jumped up in the air, flopped to the ice, and Bobby Clark looked at him in amazement and said, Wayne, what are you doing? And he said, well, Fraser hasn't called anything all night. So I said, you're right, I'm going to start right now. And I gave him an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty. And he thanked me. He said, thanks, it's about time you called something. And he stormed off the ice. But he's such a great ambassador. I mean, as I say, there's not enough superlatives in the dictionary to describe him.
I think the 5 goals that he scored here on December 31st against the Philadelphia Flyers, when he went from 45 to 50 in 39 games, I mean, that was just an unbelievable night. 50 goals in 39 games, I don't think anybody is ever going to come close to that record, the fastest 50 in the history of the game, and that's a night I will take with me to my grave.
Well, one of the most devastating moments for you occurred right here. Did he provide any encouragement for you at all?
Well, I think that certainly Wayne Gretzky is a guy that always showed great humility, always made everybody feel part of the team. I guess the best thing that he did for me was the following year we win the Stanley Cup, and he hands me the Stanley Cup right off the bat as the youngest member of the team, but certainly showed that he was pulling everybody together and everybody was part of one thing.
You know, I think if one sticks out in my mind, 50 and 39 was incredible, because, you know, he had scored 15 goals, I think it was, in 5 games or something ridiculous like that. And I know Walter was prepared to come out to Vancouver for the game after. And he had to phone him and say, listen, Dad, I did it tonight. Don't worry about coming out. I doubt that one will ever be matched.
Well, I think, first of all, when I first walked in the dressing room and saw him, it's like disbelief. There's absolutely no way that this kid can be the phenom they're talking about. And at the end of the year, he tied Dion for league scoring. And I think I was here for 11 games, and I saw things in that 11 games that I'd never seen before from any player. And I played with some good ones, and it's amazing. And the thing about it was is that I think the greatest memory is how much he enjoyed playing the game as an 18-year-old. And he was getting hit, and he was getting whacked, and none of it made any difference to him. It was just absolute fun to play the game, and he made it that way for everybody else that was in the dressing room with him.
He will be forever young in Edmonton, Alberta. Wayne Gretzky revolutionized the game of hockey here in the 1980s. Take a look at this. In 9 Oilers seasons, Wayne Gretzky had 4 Stanley Cups here, 8 Hart trophies, 7 Art Ross trophies. He holds 74 Edmonton Oilers records. Quite an accomplishment. His final game tomorrow, 3-2 Oilers win this one. We're back in a moment.
RG. Well, hello there, and welcome to our show. Along with David Pratt in Vancouver, I'm Lisa Bowes in Toronto. Well, Dave, how many practices do you think Wayne Gretzky has participated in over his career?
I don't know, Lisa, but whatever it is, it's probably a record. Saturday, Gretzky took part in his last NHL practice. In this century, there are a handful of athletes that are just truly bigger than the game they played. In baseball, it was Babe Ruth. In basketball, it was Michael Jordan. And in hockey, it still is Wayne Gretzky. Sunday in New York, Gretzky will play his last game in the NHL. With more, here's Paul Romanek.
All right, now this is where you have a hockey practice. Beautiful facility. We're in Rye, New York, which is about an hour outside of Manhattan, right on the water, a place called Playland, and the site of Wayne Gretzky's final practice as a member of the New York Rangers, in fact, of his NHL career. Pretty good crowd turned out to watch him. A number of records being set, though. You look back on Wayne Gretzky's career, over 60 National Hockey League records, numerous records with the Edmonton Oilers, with the Los Angeles Kings, and he is now, I would bet, setting a record for the most retirement announcement press conferences. Thursday in Ottawa, of course, when he all but announced his retirement. Friday officially in New York. Again on Saturday after the practice. And that's not to be confused, his last practice with his last game, which is coming up on Sunday, which you don't want to confuse with his last game day skate, which wasn't Thursday in Ottawa because he didn't skate then. It was Monday here before they played Tampa. Anyway, you get the idea. There was a bigger turnout than usual for a Rangers practice. Not a huge throng by any means, but a good complement of cameras, mics, and notepads amongst the people, kids, fans, old friends, all there to watch a guy go to work, if you can call it that. It's never really been work for Wayne.
I've always just purely loved it. And from the time I started playing organized hockey, the first hockey team that I made, I remember the excitement and the thrill I had when they told me I was on the team. I get that same feeling and excitement when a team plays its first game at the beginning of the year, and I had that feeling this year. It's a feeling that's very special and never changed.
It's the stuff that we'll never really know or experience that makes this a great job. The drills, the stops and starts, the mundaneness of practice is offset by the laughs and the camaraderie.
I mean, the goals and assists, championships you'll never forget because you're always going to see highlights of it at different times and different things. But for me personally, I said this the other day, I love being around the locker room. You know, I drop my kids off at school at 8 o'clock, and we normally don't practice till 11 or 11:30, so normally I'm here by 8:30, quarter to 9. So I get a good hour of just being in the locker room with the trainers and some of the other guys that come in early and just talk about what's going on and watch highlights from the night before of hockey. And then that special moment of that 10 minutes before practice when everybody's getting dressed and the camaraderie that we feel, that's what I'm going to really desperately miss.
For the first little while after retirement, you get the feeling that Wayne will be doing a lot of nothing, a lot of watching.
And when I got in there today, they told me they had a present for me that that I'd shocked them that I was leaving, and they weren't fully prepared for this, but they gave me a beautiful gift. They've heard me bragging for the last couple of years that I love this chair that Mr. Steinbrenner has in his office, and they went out and got me this big chair, and it was pretty emotional. I went in the back room again after that, and had a little bit of a tear. They also gave me a lifetime pass from Paul Beeston and Major League Baseball to for myself and a guest to any Major League Baseball game, which was very thrilling, very flattering.
About 24 hours from the end of the practice will come the end of a great career, and that had started to set in.
I haven't dwelled on it yet. It probably won't hit me until tomorrow when the buzzer finally rings. Then it'll really hit me.
And as the end drew closer, it was time for a little fun.
At the end there, John, after we skated, he told me he wanted me to do a couple extra down and backs. And I said, no, I retire right here. And but I said, I'll lead the stretch. So I led the stretch, and we were all kind of talking. And one of the guys I think it was Harvey said he wanted to dress tomorrow night, and Darren said he wasn't taking his spot. So we're kind of giggling about that.
Remember this career however you like. You'll probably remember a goal or a great play, but I think that what Gretzky will remember is a great career surrounded by great friends, teammates. And really, you know what, that's what it was all about, was that little bit of fun there on the ice with the picture. I mean, that to me said a lot more about what the joy of hockey brings to Wayne Gretzky than any great move or great goal.
And to a large degree, that's what Wayne Gretzky's going to miss the most. Obviously, the high moments, the competitive aspects of winning and losing and championships and achievements, that's what most of the fans are going to remember. What Wayne Gretzky's going to remember is being out with his buddies every day practicing, and the camaraderie that comes with being part of a team. And you can see that was hard for him today, that this was his last practice. And there's probably lots of times he's laced on the skates and thought, this is a grind today. But I think this really put it in perspective in terms of the friendship and the fellowship that people have on a hockey team. And anybody who's played hockey, whether you're 10 years old or playing in an old-timer league at 60, the best part about it is hanging around the dressing room, having a few laughs and having a few beers.
Although Wayne Gretzky is just like everybody else in that he doesn't necessarily love commuting, because he lives in Manhattan. This practice facility is in Rye, which is about an hour or so from Manhattan, and he says he's not going to miss the drive at all. That's one thing he won't miss. He likes sticking around in the city. The big game coming up, he mentioned that he's starting to think about it. It's starting to dawn on him the reality, the finality of the situation. What do we look for?
Well, I think what we're going to look for is a much more emotional Wayne Gretzky. We saw some of that emotion on Thursday night in Ottawa. Friday at the actual press conference to announce his formal retirement, he was very cool, handled it very well. And again today, I think tomorrow the full weight of is going to hit him, and it's going to be a difficult day for him in many respects. So, but the ceremony itself, there's going to be a pregame ceremony, there's going to be a postgame ceremony, lots of special dignitaries and friends coming in for this one. It's going to be a special, special day.
Well, every single second of our lives, we're crossing a finish line of one sort or another, and Wayne Gretzky will cross a big one tomorrow as his career will come to a close. Send you now back to Sports Desk.
Thanks, guys. We have a very busy Sunday planned for you. It starts at 6 a.m. Pacific. That's 9 o'clock Eastern with John Wells and Sports Desk Extra. That is followed by That's Hockey right after the game. And then at 9 o'clock Pacific, midnight Eastern, it's Last Call with our special guests, Richard Brodeur, Paul Reinhardt, Tony Tanti, and Glenn Hanlon. It's The Final Word.
From Great Expectations to the grand finale, Wayne Gretzky, his name in lights one last time. Well, today, we turn the switch off. His final day in the National Hockey League. New York City is showing up in numbers. Fans from Vancouver, BC, Los Angeles, California, New York City, Toronto, and Ottawa. Ready to give the great one the great send-off. The wheels are in motion for this send-off of Wayne Gretzky. In fact, Mercedes-Benz is ready to present an S500 to the great one. They've been shining it up all afternoon and ready to send him off in fine style.
Sportsnet's special presentation of The End of an Era is brought to you by Chevrolet.
Here as the end of an era continues and Wayne Gretzky finishes off his National Hockey League career, 20 years in the NHL. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the corner of 7th Avenue and West 31st in New York City, right behind Madison Square Garden. I'm Darren Millard. Welcome to a CTV Sportsnet special, End of an Era, as we say goodbye to Wayne Gretzky. Chris Simpson is with me in New York City, has been traveling around MSG throughout the day. Several special guests to tell you about, including a conversation with Wayne Gretzky. We saw him in the hallway about an hour and a half ago. Wayne arrived at the arena about 11 a.m. this morning, brought his dad along with him, and Walter is also inside the arena, and Chris Simpson will catch up with him as well. The atmosphere in New York City, I have to tell you, not quite what you expect in Canada the last couple of days. Papers in Toronto, Edmonton, Vancouver have been flooded with stories. In New York, it's kind of taken a back seat. Not today, though. The fans, an unbelievable number. The police say maybe double what you would normally expect on a New York Ranger game. All showing up, all looking for tickets, but no problem with scalping today because there just are no tickets to be had. One quote is that fans are being offered up to $1,000 for a level 3 seat, which is absolutely unbelievable, but hey, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Had the opportunity as well of riding up the elevator to the dressing room with Adam Graves, Darren Langdon, Mark Savard, and these guys, veteran National Hockey League players, especially Adam Graves, and it was like they were kids in a candy store. Adam Graves was picking up buttons. He was grabbing a program. He was talking about it, and he was explaining, you know what, this just doesn't happen every single day. You don't get to say goodbye to Wayne Gretzky, and he was unbelievable for an 82-game Well, game 82 of a National Hockey League schedule. Mentioned Chris Simpson is with us here in New York. She's standing in front of Madison Square Garden to set the scene for us. Chris?
Well, the hustle and bustle of the Big Apple is taking on even greater proportions today, and of course, it's all because of the great one. There hasn't been this much excitement around Madison Square Garden since the seventh game of the Stanley Cup Finals in 1994. And for a game that really shouldn't mean anything, the Rangers are out of the playoffs. Well, of course, to hockey fans around the world, it means everything, because it's Wayne Gretzky's last.
Okay, thanks, Chris. We will have wall-to-wall coverage of this event. We are on the air for the next hour leading up to the 3 o'clock start time of the Rangers against the Pittsburgh Penguins, and they will be on after the game, bringing Wayne Gretzky's press conference after he finishes off and takes off the final pair of skates of his NHL career. We'll be on the air from 6 o'clock until 8 o'clock at Madison Square Garden. We will also bring you pictures from his final game in Canada. We had a camera focused on Wayne Gretzky against the Ottawa Senators on Thursday night. Isolation of the great one, and it doesn't get any better than that. And while fans here are clamoring for tickets, not everybody can be in New York for this momentous occasion. Others are piling into Wayne Gretzky's restaurant in Toronto and standing by. With a live report is our Trevor Thompson. Trevor?
Darren, I know that Gretzky's a hot commodity where you're at in New York, but it's hard to imagine he's any hotter there than he is here at his own restaurant, Wayne Gretzky's, in downtown Toronto. It's hard to find a place to stand back here, let alone find a place to sit. And back in the back, Studio 99, they plan to show the game on two big screens for anybody who can manage to squeeze their way in. Now, I've been told that later on today in Gretzky's final game, he'll use no less than 40 sticks and wear about three different game day jerseys, and that's an incredible amount. Where they'll go, I don't know. But what those things will go for after the game is a really big question. Gretzky memorabilia will definitely be hot. They're on sale here at the back. You can get Gretzky jerseys, Gretzky t-shirts, Gretzky buttons, and of course people are here just to check everything out. So, Darren, that's the scene right here. I'll be back. I'll be here throughout the day. We'll come back later on, find out exactly what's happening, talk to a few people. But for now, let's go back to you in New York.
Okay, thank you, Trevor. Pittsburgh Penguins providing the opposition for this final game of Wayne Gretzky's at Madison Square Garden. Jaromir Jagr, Penguins captain, was not supposed to play in this game, but when he heard Wayne retire on Friday, he said, I have to be in New York. I have to play in that game. And Jaromir Jagr will be in the lineup for the Pittsburgh Penguins, an important game for them as they battle for position in the Eastern Conference. This is also an important game of sorts for Wayne Gretzky in the statistical department. Gordie Howe holds the record for most consecutive 10 goal seasons at 24. Mark Messier has recorded 10 goal season in 20 straight seasons. Wayne Gretzky is sitting at 19. He has 9 goals so far this season, one more to match his good buddy Mark Messier. He of course has tons of statistics, an incredible number of goals, assists, and with a look back at some of his finer moments, here is our Rob Faltz.
He is the embodiment of the Canadian dream, where any young boy can grow up to play hockey in the NHL. To look at him, you'd have to say, he's too small. To see him skate, you'd have to say, he's too slow. But after 20 years, he is the finest player the game has ever seen.
Gretzky coming in with McSorley to Gretzky. He scores!
He is Wayne Gretzky. He began his hockey career as a 5-year-old. At age 10, he finished the 1971-72 season with 378 goals in just 69 games. In 1979, the Edmonton Oilers became part of the World Hockey Association NHL merger. And when Wayne scored his first goal in just the third game of the season, even his most ardent admirers could not have predicted what was to be. He had embarked on a journey that was to change the face of hockey. The next 10 years with the Oilers were, arguably, the greatest of his career, as he led the Oilers to 4 Stanley Cups. But this would be the last time the Great One would hoist Lord Stanley's hallowed hardware and drink from its basin. A storybook wedding to a Hollywood starlet only heightened his allure.
Be faithful to you alone.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
At the peak of his game and a national icon, in 1987, he led Team Canada to another Canada Cup by setting up Mario Lemieux for the hockey shot heard round the world.
Here's Lemieux poking at the center. Lemieux ahead to Gretzky.
In 1988, financial problems for owner Peter Pocklington forced Gretzky's sale to Los Angeles. Leaving Edmonton was more than he could take.
There comes a time
Edmonton's loss was a boon for the NHL and hockey in Southern California. The Great One had become a darling of the Hollywood elite. Wayne Gretzky put hockey front and center on the map and became the number one sports celebrity in North America. A disappointing stay in St. Louis in 1996 with disciplinarian Mike Keenan had many thinking that Gretzky's time may be coming to an end. But Gretzky was looking for that elusive fifth cup and relief from his recent bad experience. He signed with the New York Rangers later that summer, joining his old pal Marc Messier for one more kick at the can. But it was not to be. The next year, Messier would be gone, and the once powerful Rangers team fell out of the playoff picture. At age 38, it was time to pack it in.
It's obvious that today that I officially have retired, and Sunday will be my last game. I should take my own advice, huh? But it's for the last couple of weeks, a lot of people have been asking me why this is the time. And it's a gut feel. Something that I really believe is right. I love the game and I love to play. Gordie Howe told me the other day that he still loves to play and he's playing in charity games and he's 70 years old. And whether it's now, next year, or 20 years from now, I'm always going to miss the National Hockey League and the game of hockey.
Wayne Gretzky has more records than HMV. He holds or shares 61 records listed in NHL's official guide, including 6 goal-scoring records and an amazing 92 goals in the 81-82 season. 6 assist records. He has more assists than any player's total points. 12 scoring records and 13 consecutive 100-point seasons. And 15 playoff records. He has the most playoff goals and assists. He has made more play-by-play announcers go hoarse than any other to lace up the skates.
Gretzky grabs it into Sandstrom, and Sandstrom back to Gretzky. Gretzky scores!
Now to Taylor, to Gretzky, and he scores!
Linden is pressured.
Gretzky in front, saved by Flaherty. The rebound, scores!
Kevin Lowe off the glass, kept in by Duchesne. A rolling puck hitter, but Gretzky scores!
He will always be best remembered for his pinpoint passing. Right on the tape in the open ice, or when he set up shop behind the opposing net.
And he thought all the way. Gretzky weaving out. Joined by Curry.
Gretzky. Nice pass to Curry. Curry in the clear. He scores! Gretzky. Centering it. They score! And back to Gretzky. Gretzky up front. Messier scores!
Gretzky takes the pass. In front, Sandstrom scores!
Left side to Gretzky. To Granato. In front, he shoots. He scores!
Gretzky is back on the net. He gets the pass. Gretzky now trying to work it in front.
This is a moment that will stay with us for the rest of our lives. As sports fans around the world rejoice and give thanks to the foremost hockey player of all time, it is only fitting that the great one paid homage to perhaps the only one that can be considered greater.
Obviously, I was lucky enough to be God-gifted. For some reason, the good Lord gave me a special talent. And maybe it wasn't a talent he gave me, maybe it was a passion he gave me.
In all of creation, all things great and small, you are the one that surpasses them all. More precious than any diamond or pearl, they broke the mold when you came in this world. I'm trying hard to figure out just how I ever did without. The warmth of your smile, the heart of a child that's deep inside leaves me purified. Never could keep. When I look into your eyes, I know that it's true. God must have spent a little more time on you.
Tough to beat American patriotism, but Canada is giving them a good run. The flag waving continues as Canadian fans show up to give the great one a great send-off. Live from New York, it's a Sportsnet special, the end of an era. It's almost a certainty he'll be fast-tracked into the Hockey Hall of Fame next November. You would think the uniform he was wearing in these pictures will be the one he wears into the hall. Expecting a very emotional afternoon here at Madison Square Garden in New York. Game time starts at 3 o'clock. Normal game for an NHL, maybe about 2.5 hours, 3 hours. Expected to go well beyond that. Plenty of pregame ceremonies as well as intermission ceremonies, and then at the end where the NHL is planning something. So plenty of emotion there, but it's going to be tough to top what happened Thursday night in Ottawa. You watched it live on CTV Sportsnet. Wayne Gretzky's final game in Canada, and while the announcement was never made official prior to that game, all the signs were there and the fans gave him an incredible send-off, and send-off fitting for Wayne Gretzky. So in continuing with that theme, we thought that it was well fitting that we would give you a look at Wayne Gretzky, and only Wayne Gretzky, as 99 takes center stage.
This has been a really effective line for the Rangers. Malhotra has played some good hockey in the last 2 weeks. Against Tampa on Monday, this is one of the most effective lines for the Rangers.
Ottawa changed up. The Rangers have as well, and you'll hear the crowd every time 99 comes over the boards, and Gretzky's on the ice now with John McClain heading for the front of the net, Nick Sundstrom. Sundstrom's after the puck. The centering pass, Gretzky misfired, and Rhodes stopped him. Great pass, just not the finish we expect. There's a shot from the blue line. Gretzky trying to get the rebound on that shot from the point by Ender. And out come the Senators with the puck. McClain behind the net. 2 seconds to go in the penalty. Graves out front. Almost stuffed the Gretzky pass in. Tamer. The Graves. 99. Passes out front. Rhodes makes the save. of Chris Tamer from the right point and moved in. Penalty's over. Ottawa's back at full strength. The game is scoreless. Under 4 minutes to play in the first period, and the puck's cleared down the ice.
How do you like that for respect? The Ottawa Senator fans are owing at a missed opportunity by the Rangers. A great setup again by Gretzky behind the net.
McLean's in front of the net. Sundstrom defers to Gretzky. To McLean in front for Sundstrom. To Leach. Scores! Brian Leach. And it's a 1-1 game, 43 seconds into period number two. Spontaneously, the fans in this building have risen to their feet in salute to the great Gretzky. Seconds to go. Fans are chanting thank you. Ten seconds left. All night long. Nobody's worried about the score, including the Senators. In those final moments on the ice, what a wonderful move by the Ottawa players as Igor Kravchuk finally broke the ice and led the way over to say so long.
And you can see how emotional it is for the Gretzky family.
Nobody's leaving the building, though very few, and there'll be another salute. Tonight, just a single star, and it's Gretzky, and it's as it should be.
Appropriate words out of the mouth of Jim Houston.
incredible ovation from the fans in Ottawa, and you have to give it, maybe it's the Canadianism, but that was a very important game for the Senators as they fight for first place in the Eastern Conference, and they let the game run its course, knowing full well that that was likely Wayne Gretzky's final game in Canada, but they let the game do the talking for the first 55 minutes and then decided to take over the contest and give Wayne Gretzky the appropriate and fitting send-off to a career in the National Hockey League in Canada. And you know what? I don't care whether you're in Toronto or whether you're in Vancouver or Calgary. I don't think any fans could have accomplished what the Ottawa fans did on Thursday night. Wayne Gretzky has ensured that every person important to him throughout his NHL and hockey career on and off the ice is in attendance at this final farewell at Madison Square Garden this afternoon. And that includes his first agent, the man that negotiated the contract with Indianapolis of the World Hockey Association and the early deals with the Edmonton Oilers. Chris Simpson now with Gus Padale.
Well, in true Gretzky fashion, Wayne has made sure that a lot of people that were close to him over the years are here for this, his final game. And with me now is Gus Padale. Gus, of course, being his agent way back when he was 15 and really started off his career. Tell us first a bit about your personal background with Wayne.
Well, my first personal background was I met Wayne when he was playing Junior B with the Seneca Nats. And I looked at him play four games in a row, and I fell in love with him and felt that he was really special, and it certainly has proven right.
And so special that he gave the call to you after his press conference in Ottawa, and I know it meant a lot to you. Just tell us a bit about that phone call.
Actually, it was the press conference in New York, and I wasn't able to make the press conference down here. And about 11:15, the phone rang, and I thought it was somebody else. I says, "Oh, hi, Mike," and he says, "No, it's Wayne." Actually, I caught me so much off guard, I don't think I focused for 5 minutes because I wasn't expecting a call from Wayne the day of the press conference, and we had a chat for about 20 minutes, and he was happy I was coming down, and he says, "Gus, there's a party or celebration after the game, and hopefully you'll be there." And I wouldn't miss it for the world.
Well, Gus, thanks so much for sharing your thoughts with us, and let's get in and enjoy the game.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Okay, Chris, thank you very much. You know, New Yorkers are now fully entrenched and involved in this Wayne Gretzky send-off, but if you're not in New York, there may not be a more emotional city to be in right now than Edmonton. We are joined now by Roger Millions, who is inside Moe's Sports Parlor just off Calgary Trail in Edmonton. And Roger, what's the atmosphere like in his first NHL city?
Well, Darren, it's picking up just a little bit here, but it's the noon hour in Edmonton, and quite frankly, it's a little subdued. And don't be surprised if it stays that way. I know Wayne wants this to be a happy moment, but here in Edmonton, I think there's some sincere sadness to see him go because they have adopted him as their own native son, and they're still looking about it, reading about it, trying out exactly what people feel about Wayne Gretzky's departure. There's indeed some sadness here at Edmonton as he gets set to play against the Penguins this afternoon.
Was it very sullen, quiet on Friday when he made the official announcement?
It was. The whole town actually stopped. It was one of those times where you could just stop time and see, you know, no one was paying attention to anything except what was going on with Wayne Gretzky and his announcement at Madison Square Garden. And I think that's the story about Edmonton. This guy is going to be honored in this city. They're already talking about different ways they might do that. For instance, renaming 99th Street here in Edmonton as Gretzky Way. Perhaps the new terminal at the International Airport will be the Gretzky Terminal. All of this talk has happened, and it could happen.
We're going to be joined by Glenn Sather in a couple of minutes here at Madison Square Garden, but what's the Oilers' official take on this?
Well, I think that they're happy for him that he's made his own decision, Darren, but at this point, they'd like to see him play as well. Let's face it, he's a great boon for Edmonton, he's great for the National Hockey League, and the Oilers would like to see him on the ice as long as he could. However, they're happy for Wayne Gretzky because he has meant an awful lot to their franchise and the whole city of Edmonton.
Well, I know it's a down day for Edmonton and fans who don't want to see him go, but Roger, go enjoy the game. We know you'll be watching.
Indeed, Darren. You enjoy New York.
Okay, thanks, Roger. Still ahead on this Sportsnet special, we talk to Oilers president Glenn Sather. Wayne Gretzky's name on the marquee one final day. The end of an era on CTV Sportsnet, live from New York.
I am the Rocky Mountains.
The form of a baseball glove. It's the exact same chair that George Steinbrenner owns, owner of the New York Yankees. Wayne Gretzky saw it one day, thought it would be he would like it, and talked about it enough that the players finally chipped in. The training staff went out and bought him a gold pass for Major League Baseball, a lifetime pass. He can go to any game. It's good for Wayne Gretzky and one other person. Plenty to tell you about from here in New York. It's an extravagant ceremony. We're expecting it to go upwards and into 3 hours. Wayne Gretzky here, surrounded by friends and family, and of course his father is here, and Wayne is titling this a celebration, and I'm not sure that Walter Gretzky really agrees with that. Walter standing by with our Christine Simpson.
Walter, a very special day, one of many that you and your family have had following Wayne's career, but give me your thoughts as we prepare to watch his final NHL game.
Well, I'm looking forward to this afternoon, and yet I'm not looking forward to it. I want to see him one more time, and knowing this is the last time. And when I think about that, I think the very first time he ever skated on the Nith River, and he was a little three-year-old.
So could you imagine at that time that Wayne would go on to have the type of career he's had and impact hockey, not only as a hockey player, but as the type of person he's been in the game of hockey? You talk about how proud you are as his father.
Never, ever would I have dreamed this. As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, I said to Wayne, I said, "You believe that this has all happened, Wayne?" He says, "You know, Dad," he says, "sometimes I have to pinch myself because I don't believe it myself." And that's certainly, I'm tenfold that, how I think.
Now, you have almost your entire family here. Tell us who made the trip from Brantford.
Well, Brent did. That's the youngest boy. Keith is here. And Glenn is here. The only one who isn't here is our daughter, Kim. She's expecting shortly, so she stayed behind. And, of course, Wayne's mom is here.
Now, you were also telling me about two special friends of yours that Wayne wanted to make sure were in attendance at today's game. Tell us about that.
Oh, that's true. We have two people who come to watch all the games at our house because we have a dish so we get all of Wayne's games. And they never, ever miss Eddie and Butch. And one brings the chips, the other one brings the donuts, and we have kind of a celebration every time. And before we left for New York, they both brought the same thing before we left the house. And Wayne phoned then, and he said, "Make sure you bring Eddie and Butch," and they're here.
Now, just a few minutes ago, you and I were in the hallway. When Wayne walked by, he seemed very happy, very excited, not nervous or depressed.
No, he wouldn't be depressed, but he's very sure this is the right thing for him to be doing. That's why he seemed that way. He's very happy with the decision that he's made.
Well, we're glad that you took the time to share your thoughts with us on this perhaps sad but celebratory day, and we'll all enjoy the game today.
Thank you very, very much.
Thanks. Darren?
Okay, thank you, Christine. A few of his ex-teammates on hand this afternoon. We're going to run through the guest list a little bit later on. But when Wayne made his announcement official on Friday night, it shocked a lot of players, and we have this reaction from around the National Hockey League.
His imagination that he wasn't going to let anybody else's barriers be his standard. He could look at the game and change the game, as he did behind the net, going to the red line, the opposite side of the benches, keeping everybody in front of him. I knew on the ice you can change your percentages because all you need to do is get open anywhere on the ice, and he's going to see you, he's going to find you.
The privilege of playing with Wayne was not just in the games, but also to watch him in practice and see the way that he conducted himself away from the game, and the passion and the love for the game that he had.
He's a fun guy to be around, and you see what he brings to the rink, you see how hard he works during practice and such. And I think it forces you to want to be better. So I think playing with him, it's definitely been a help to everybody that's played with him. I think he makes your career better because he forces you to want to compete at his level.
Well, I think my favorite moments are more having to do with practice and being around him every day. I know just doing two-on-ones, I try and position myself in line so that I can go against him and whoever else he's with, because I know he's going to try and make that pass through me, and I'm always trying to stop it. And you know, I'd say almost, you know, probably 99% of the time he gets the pass through, and I go, "How did you do that?" And he's got a little smile on his face.
He's been a phenomenal player, but I think a much more phenomenal person for the game. The league's going to miss him a lot.
He wanted to be on the ice. He wanted the puck all the time. He was the last guy off the ice. He was probably the coach's dream.
When it came to individual talent and individual skills, I mean, he was such a natural and greatest player ever to play the game of hockey, maybe the greatest athlete to play any sport. But it was a joy to coach him. I mean, he's I wish every player was as easy to coach as Wayne was.
Wayne, I think, meant more to this sport than any athlete has meant to any sport, both on and off the ice. He's just been phenomenal on the ice, all the records he holds, and he's been the consummate ambassador for our game.
I don't think there will be anybody. There may be someone come along at one point that may be as talented as him. Who knows? There may be someone who will be able to fill the void as far as being the superstar of the NHL. But to fill the void of everything he accomplished, I don't think there ever will be.
No one passes the puck like him, and no one sees a game like him. As far as I'm concerned, he could probably play until he's 45 or 50.
He's playing the game that he loves to play. He's played it since he was that high. It's not the money, it's the game. He loves the game, and we need more guys that love this game and play for the love of the game.
Wayne has made sure everybody's in attendance that had an impact on his career, and maybe nobody's impacted that more than Edmonton Oilers president and general manager Glenn Sather. When did you get the call from Wayne?
Well, actually, I got the call first from Neil Smith a couple of days earlier, but Wayne called me himself. We were playing in a game at Edmonton, called me in the press box and asked me if I'd come to New York, and it was pretty tough to lie to him, so I said, I've already been invited, Wayne, but I appreciate you calling me. And he was pretty excited, said that he was very happy that I'd come and be involved in the ceremonies.
I guess now we know why Neil wouldn't trade him at the deadline when you inquired about him. Wayne Gretzky, of course, has meant so much to hockey in Canada. He listed you as one of the four most influential people in his life through the course of hockey. Where does Wayne Gretzky rate in your life?
Well, I expect that by saying that about me, I think he was being very nice and flattering. I don't think anybody could really teach Wayne an awful lot about hockey. As far as my career is concerned, I'm sure that we wouldn't have won the Stanley Cups we did, or I wouldn't be in the Hall of Fame like I am if it hadn't been for Wayne. He had a very dramatic effect on what happened in Edmonton for all of us, not only myself, but the city and Mark Messier and all the players that played with him. He was the guy that kept everything together for those years.
Everybody talks about Wayne as a person, not necessarily as much as points. Do you find it amazing that he hasn't really changed that much from his first year in Edmonton to today?
You know, I don't find it amazing because I met Phyllis and Walter, Wayne's parents, when he was very young, and you could see that he was from a strong family background, had tremendous upbringing, and I think that it's carried him throughout his entire career, and he's the one guy, I think, in all professional sports that has really never had a blemish in his career. And, you know, when you meet his parents, you know right away why he's like he is today, and it's a great compliment to them because of what he's turned out to be like.
Expecting a very emotional afternoon, what are your thoughts going inside the building?
Well, I'm sure it's going to be very emotional for everyone, and you know, Wayne has tried to do the thing to ease the pain for everyone by saying this is going to be a celebration, not some kind of a mourning period. It'll be difficult for all of us that have known him so well and seen him play and do the terrific things that he has done. For all Canadians, I think it's the one genuine person that we've all been able to look up to. And Canada has a short history, but hockey has been right in front of all of us as far as the prominence is concerned. And Wayne has been really an inspirational leader for all Canadians.
Well, he has the commemorative 99 button on. Glenn Sather, we'll let you go inside and enjoy the game, and good luck in the playoffs as well.
Thank you very much.
Glenn Sather, president and general manager of the Edmonton Oilers, joining us outside Madison Square Garden. Right now, festivities continue. We're getting ready for game time, but let's send you to Toronto and Wayne Gretzky's bar with our Trevor Thompson.
Darren, I know it's Harry down there in New York, but you should see it inside of Gretzky's. One look behind me will tell the story. They're lined up to get inside Studio 99, where Daphne Hunter is about to entertain. It looks like thousands in here today. Daphne, tell me about what's going on.
Well, we're showing the last and final most wonderful game on our 40-foot giant wall screen in Studio 99. We're not charging admission, and we've pretty much invited the whole city of Toronto to come on down. And as you can see, they're all here.
Now, you're the general manager here, so you have a lot of dealings with Wayne. What's he like as an owner of the restaurant?
He's great. He is still the most humble person that you see on every television interview. He cares about the staff. He comes in. He visits. He eats pierogies, you know, just like his mom used to make him, his favorite dish, of course. Comes in with the family, hangs out. It's great.
The other night at one of his retirement speeches, he said that he wouldn't mind being an NHL franchise owner. Your thoughts on that based on how he is as a restaurant owner?
Oh, you know what? If I had the cash, I'd buy in with him in a minute. You know, what a great guy to have with you, always. You know?
I know the restaurant's been busy all week long. Have people been, what's their mood been like? Have they been up, down, sad, happy about this occasion? What's the mood been like?
I think initially when he first announced and they weren't quite sure if he was going to do it, they were a little sad and they were thinking, oh, we don't want this to happen. But he's made it such a positive thing that everybody's, hey, that's a great idea. You know, good for him. He is going to get to play more golf. We'll actually get to see him more as opposed to just being able to see him play hockey. Now they can come here to the Shrine and see him live more often.
Your personal feelings?
I'm so happy for him. I think that he should be able to do whatever he wants to do. He has contributed more to the game, to the sport, and to the honor of the sport than any other player. And it's time for him to relax and have a little bit of fun of his own and enjoy his family.
Well, if I don't let you let these folks in, we could all get trampled. So I'll let you do that. And for now, we'll go back to New York and Darren Millard.
Okay, thank you, Trevor. You know, we're just getting warmed up outside Madison Square Garden, and so is Wayne Gretzky stepping onto the ice for the final time for a pregame skate. The end of an era, Wayne Gretzky's last National Hockey League contest from New York and Madison Square Gardens continues. It's a CTV Sportsnet exclusive.
You've never experienced the thrill of Mach 3. It's wake-up time. Introducing Mach 3.
Back in Canada. And it was very emotional. Ryan, mixed feeling. One, that I was happy for him that he finally decided to retire. And the other one, that we're losing a great player that has done so much for the game. So it's it was mixed emotion.
Were you surprised at all by his decision or by the timing of it?
A little bit. I think he waited a long time until the end of the season to announce it, but I'm sure it went through his mind throughout the season and just didn't want to tell anybody, and just to make sure that he's making the right decision. It's probably the biggest decision he's going to have to make in his life, and you have to make sure that you know the answer before you speak, so I think that's what he did.
What would you say Wayne Gretzky has meant to the National Hockey League over the last 20 years that he's been a part of it?
Well, he's meant a lot to the game. He's really changed the game and changed the approach of the young players growing up now, and all wanted to be like him. And he really changed the game when he came in the league in the early 80s and with the scoring titles and with all the records that he's accomplished and the Stanley Cups and being such a great team guy. Really changed the outlook on hockey players.
You played against him for so many years, but you also played with him, the 87 Canada Cup, All-Star Games. Do you have a favorite memory yourself of Wayne Gretzky?
Well, it would have to be when I played with him, of course, in the Canada Cup, and just being able to spend so much time with him, a month and a half, and practicing every day and learning from him and knowing what it takes to be a winner. Having a chance to play with him those last two games against the Russians and winning the two winning goals, scoring the two winning goals assisted by Wayne was something that I can cherish for the rest of my life.
Have you spoken to Wayne at all recently?
Not recently. I certainly intend to drop him a note or give him a call.
If you had had the chance to talk with him over the last couple of weeks, would you have tried to talk him out of retiring?
No, I think it's very, everybody's different, and you have to do what you feel is right for yourself and your family, and nobody else can tell you that, and they can certainly try to keep you in the game, but I think it has to come from your own self and make sure that you're making the right decision.
Wayne said all along that he didn't want a farewell tour. He didn't want the circus that comes with everybody knowing that was going to be his last season. You had that when people started to realize that this was going to be your last season. But did you see that as a distraction, or was it a good chance for you to say goodbye to the fans?
No, if I remember, I waited as long as I could to announce it, and I announced it with, I think, a month left in the season. So there was not too many cities that I had to go to and go through that. But, you know, it was just great to go in every city and see the affection that the people had for you, and they really appreciated your work over the years and what you have done for the game, and I certainly enjoyed it.
You, like Wayne, have both left the game at a time where you're still young enough and healthy enough and have a skill level that you obviously could continue playing for years and really be a dominant force in the league. But having that ability to decide, does it make it a harder decision or an easier decision that you're deciding on your own terms?
Well, I think you have to decide whatever's best for yourself, your health, and your family. and you have all these three things together. And that was my decision to retire because of health reason at the time. You might have different reasons to retire, so everybody's different.
You've adjusted to life after hockey. What do you think the biggest adjustment's going to be for Wayne, realizing come training camp that he's not going to be, you know, heading into training camp with the rest of the guys and on the road?
Yeah, that's the toughest thing to adjust to a new life and not being able to spend so much time with the guys. And he's been doing it for 20 years, so it's going to be a big change in his life. But he has kids like all of us, and he's going to take care of his kids, drive them to school, and find some other things to keep him busy during the day. I'm sure he'll do very well.
He said in the press conference after the game in Ottawa that for at least a little while he wants to be away from hockey. That being said, he's also talked so much about his passion for the game, mm-hmm. his true love for the game of hockey. Do you think it's just a matter of time before Wayne is back in the game in some way?
Yeah, that's what he's been saying all along, that he wants to stay in the game. But I think it's good after 20 years of giving everything you got to the game to step away a little bit and do other things in life and travel and see the world and take care of your family. And that's what I've been doing for a couple of years and might be ready to get back in. But I'm sure he wants to take some time off and enjoy his life, and I'm sure he'll be back in the game soon.
He talked about having a lot of people giving him advice, as I'm sure they did to you as well, but that ultimately the decision had to come from within himself, and that he really talked about having a peace of mind and that he knew the time was right and that the decision he was making was the right thing. Could you understand where he was coming from talking about that peace of mind?
Yeah, it's very important that when you retire, you have to be 100% sure that you're making the right decision and you're not going to look back and regret it. And that's the toughest part, to make sure that you're on the right path and you're doing the right thing. And that's what he had to go through probably the whole season, and making sure that he was not making a mistake.
Going to be watching the game on Sunday afternoon?
Yep, I'll be glued to my television set.
Mario, thanks for letting us into your home. Sportsnet appreciates it.
My
and
pleasure.
Thanks for giving us your thoughts on Wayne Gretzky.
All right, Chris. Thanks.
He will be watching, and so will we. 20 years in the making. Wayne Gretzky's final game in the National Hockey League is minutes away. You're watching the Sportsnet special live from New York.
Who runs the Hull Olympics, Wayne's team in the Quebec Major Junior League. Harry Neal telling him what he had for the broadcast today.
Dans les habitudes, parce que les gens disent...
It's a good day to be hanging around Wayne.
Now the results of this striving for perfection and not...
...to be at MSG for Wayne Gretzky's final appearance. This was just an hour ago, the pregame skate. Wayne's using 40 sticks here today and three sweaters. One he will keep himself, one will go to Neil Smith, and he hasn't made up his mind what he'll do with the other sweater he uses today.
Something that is very difficult. I went to bed pretty early last night. I got a lot of friends and relatives here. Obviously, everyone's really excited, and so am I. It's a hard day because I know it's the right time, so I'm happy I'm leaving. But it's been my whole life, and I'm sad that this is going to be my last game. I've just loved my 21 years of professional hockey, everything I have in my life out of the NHL, and a lot of ways I'm happy it's over.
capacity crowd at Madison Square Garden for the Pittsburgh Penguins and the New York Rangers. The game's moot. This is Wayne Gretzky's swan song in professional hockey, and they're paying tribute to Wayne with a musical that's been shown the last couple of days here at MSG. He took to the ice moments ago. Good afternoon and welcome to a special edition of Hockey Night in Canada. I'm Ron McLean. Don't want to steal any of the thunder here. You could never quantify what Wayne Gretzky has meant to this business and to this sport. The only way to repay him is with a final effort here today. Christopher Reeves in the building. Superman's just sitting around the corner. Jerry Seinfeld here. It's a who's who, and it's especially a who's who of hockey personalities who know what Wayne Gretzky meant from the moment he joined the National Hockey League. They couldn't give him the Calder. They decided that wasn't fair. He didn't win the Art Ross. Marcel Dion got that. But yes, he was the NHL's most valuable player in his first season in the league. And to give you a perspective, 9 Hart trophies. In all the other major professional sports, only Kareem Abdul-Jabbar with 6 in the NBA is close. Jim Brown at 4 in the NFL, and 8 baseball players have won 3. He is the most valuable player of his time. Wayne Gretzky's last effort. Let's send you ringside. John Davidson, after the video concludes, will lead us through a pregame ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our host for today's ceremonies, a former Rangers goaltender and now the premier analyst in hockey, MSG Network's own John Davidson.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. There have been times in this arena, Madison Square Garden, when you knew that you were witnessing history, when you knew that just being here was a privilege and an honor that you would never forget. This is one of those times. Today, we are saying thank you to one of the greatest hockey players ever to play the game. And we'll do it like only you know how to do it in New York. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome number 99, Wayne Gretzky. express how much your talent and grace has meant to all of us. Before we begin tonight, several individuals want to celebrate your career and express their thanks in some small way. First, we'd like to invite to center ice those who you hold most dear, your mother Phyllis, your children Trevor, Ty, and Paulina, and your wife, of course, Janet. Assistant Captain Adam Graves, in uniform for tonight's ceremony, please welcome back Assistant Captain Jeff Bookaboom, and Rangers Captain Brian Leach. And now president of the Edmonton Oilers, Glenn Sather. Also joining us as a surprise to Wayne is the player he considers the greatest player he ever played against. He is two-time Stanley Cup winner, winner of three Hart trophies as league's MVP, and six Art Rose trophies as the league's leading scorer, Mario Lemieux. Ladies and gentlemen, our next guest is former Oiler teammate of Wayne's. Wayne recently said he is the greatest player he has ever played with. Together in Edmonton, they won four cups. They were reunited as teammates here in New York. Please welcome number 11, Marc Messier. I'd like to present you with a few gifts. Our first presenter is Gary Bettman.
Wayne, on behalf of all your fans, we're not quite ready to take up your invitation of Friday and be happy and celebrate, because I think we're all sad that you're retiring. But I have two presentations I'd like to make to commemorate today. The first is of your 61 NHL records, which is a remarkable achievement. Some of them are seasons, some of them are career records, but a number of them were records set in particular games. And since we know you're such an aficionado and fan of the game and the history and the tradition and the statistics, we're going to give you the original score sheets of 30 of those games that'll be appropriately framed, and Janet can redecorate around them. The second presentation, which is particularly appropriate in this, the millennium year of 1999, is a little different. When you take off that sweater, your jersey, after today's game, you will be the last player in the NHL to ever wear 99. You have always been, and you will always be the great one, and there will never be another. On behalf of all of your fans, we miss you and we thank you.
Thank you, Gary. And now for our next presentation, team captain Brian Leash.
Thank you very much, Wayne. On behalf of your teammates, I'd like to say how proud we are and honored to be a part of your career and present you with a 75-inch high-definition TV. Thank you very much, Wayne.
That's a high-def television, 75 inches. Congratulations, Wayne. And for our final presentation, the man who brought Wayne Gretzky to New York, Mr. Neil Smith.
Wayne, on behalf of the entire organization and John Muckler, all our great Ranger fans, we've got a car to bring out the most special person in your life, your dad. To make sure you always get back to Madison Square Garden, Dave Checketts will deliver your dad in your new car.
Celebration because I feel so lucky that I was able to play in the National Hockey League. I feel so fortunate to have played with some of the game's greatest players, play against guys who I admire so much, people like Mario Lemieux, to play with great players like Brian Leash and Adam Graves and Jeff Bookaboom, to my teammates, of course to play, as I said today, the best player I ever played with, Mark Messier. With the best player I ever played against, Mario Lemieux. And of course, you're nothing without family, and I have great parents, great brothers and sisters, some great friendships that I've developed over the years, and of course, most importantly, my kids and my wife, Janet, who I love dearly. I appreciate all the accolades. I thank Madison Square Garden and New York Rangers And of course, as I said the other day, I tell people the greatest place to play as a professional athlete is right here in New York. To the Ranger fans, thank you. Thank you all very much.
Garden. We hope you enjoyed today's pregame festivities that will continue throughout this afternoon as we celebrate the career of the great one, Wayne Gretzky. Let's have fun and enjoy the game. Thank you very much, New York.
I'm not going to kid you, Jamie. This mission
put out, you had to hit it. Get your knee bent down there. You got a long bunker shot.
When they...
30 auctions and for friends. Jaromir Jagr, of course, will have a chance to go head-to-head with Wayne Gretzky. They were the big villains in the Olympic showdown in Nagano. Phil Esposito was telling me, Phil was the first one to wear double digits when he wore the 77 here as a New York Ranger. He actually made a bid to get Wayne to New York in 1987, a year before Bruce McNall got him in Los Angeles. Phil had gone to Glen Sayre, Peter Pocklington, and had come up with a package of players and a $12 million offer. But then the folks at Madison Square Garden decided, geez, $12 million. Don't know if that's quite worth it at this stage, Phil. And they said, we got a sold-out building. Lo and behold, a decade later, he did come here to join Mark Messier as a member of the New York Rangers. It goes without saying, and it should be said, that there will be some questioning as to why Wayne chose the moment. He says it's perfect. I certainly personally believe, like many, that it is perfect. But the fact remains, the Rangers missing the playoffs 2 years in a row factored in heavily to Wayne's decision. He'd love to have played with Pavel Bure or a Mark Recchi or Theron Fleury. And when he did not see a bright future, the greatest star of the time decided he had to move on. He's going to live in New York City for the next year, so there's no chance. Wayne being the fellow he is, when Mark Messier was having his contract problem, he would never go in and raise trouble. But that's where the trouble started for the Rangers, and they've really been in a tailspin, and believe me, for the National Hockey League and for especially the Rangers, this is a critical blow to lose Gretzky right now. There you see the switch of sticks, 46. Three sweaters in the game. One for Neil Smith, one for himself, and he hasn't decided. Let's look at a few of the records. 61 NHL records held by Wayne Gretzky, 15 100-plus point seasons. There's only three men have ever had 100 assist seasons, Gretzky, Lemieux, and Bobby Orr, which tells you a little something about Bobby Orr. Four 200-plus point seasons. The closest anyone else got was Mario at 199. 50 career hat-tricks, nine career playoff hat-tricks, four Stanley Cups, three Canada Cups. There's Christopher Reeves. Superman has a ringside seat to see Wayne Gretzky. Of course, Christopher's a huge New York Rangers fan. And he's on hand. I mentioned Jerry Seinfeld is here. Lots of his old hockey pals. And you can hear they're getting set for the honoring of our neighboring nations.
Strong and free from far and wide, oh Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. We're gonna miss you, Wayne Gretzky.
Thank you.
Star-Spangled Banner with John Amarante.
Able to celebrate your retirement playing the game you love. Wayne Gretzky and the New York Rangers against Pittsburgh. Let's head up to the broadcast booth for the accounts of Wayne's final game. Harry Neal's with Bob Cole. Bob.
Thank you, Ron, and good afternoon, everybody. Well, for Wayne Gretzky, 1,487th game today. It's a big game for Pittsburgh, and it's really tough to get your head around that right now. Pittsburgh trying to move up to seventh place in the standings in this, the final day of the regular season. But there is the man of the hour.
Wayne Gretzky is making a major decision this week. You know, for a lot of players of his stature, when the end gets close, the owner or the manager or the coach or the doctor makes the decision. Let's be very happy for Wayne that none of those things happened.
He would.
Good news, Glenn Adamo, a big wig for the NHL, was watching Coach's Corner last night, as everybody does. The U.S. Hockey and Atlantic are starting. They want that patch to send down. They want the sticker. They're going to put it on all the kids, and it's going to go right across the states. Now, how come I can do that for the United States, and they listen, I can't get it in Canada?
No, it was very encouraging to make clear it's the stop patch on the back of the sweater to prevent hitting from behind. In honor of Aaron Moser and many others. Okay, now, your theory on why...
Well, I'm going to show you a couple of things why he's retiring. If you remember in Edmonton, he'd throw it out from behind, bing, 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 it'd be in the net. We got a couple of shots here. He's got nobody to put the puck in. Now, watch this here. I hope we get the one. We got a couple right off the shot. Go ahead and show this here and behind the net. Nobody's there. He gets the puck, throws it out. Before, think of Messier there. Think of Curry there.
But they got Kevin Stevens. They got John McClain. They had a few players. I'm not arguing with you.
Putting Kevin Stevens, John McClain, with Messier.
I'm just saying, well, John McClain's a goal scorer. Kevin Stevens was once
all right,
a goal
scorer. All right, then he didn't score for him. That's what I'm saying. I think we got one more. It was behind the net. I don't know whether it's this one. Yeah. There wasn't a guy. Yeah, watch. It's not a guy within 30 feet of the whole thing. He puts it out in front. Comes back, I think, here, and he puts it out in front anyhow.
Keep it going. I think it does. But so you say if Neil Smith gets a recce or gets a flurry...
Nah, that's why he's retired. I'll tell you what happened here. Here it comes back again. I think he does put it out. The whole coach's corner.
Gary Slager's a good guy. He's not going to take him out there.
You want my theory, everybody's saying it's wonderful, he retired and everything? I think he made a big mistake. I'll tell you why I think he made a big mistake. He's tired. The team is going lousy. And he's hurt. That's what happened. You never, ever retire when something like that happened. And you know, I'm going to tell you what I think happened. This is my personal opinion. About February, he was thinking about if the team was going lousy and everything like that. He was thinking about whether you're doing it or not. He said, oh, I'm going to wait to see what they do in the trade. See if they get any free agents. Nothing. They didn't do anything at all. Then he starts playing again. He's still thinking it's about, I'd say, 60-40. Then he gets hurt. Remember when he got hurt and they went on that tear?
Well, in Edmonton, he's had
some. No, I mean when he got the 6-2 and he hurt his neck.
Oh, yeah.
And they went 6 wins, 2 losses, and the paper says, who needs Gretzky here? Who needs Gretzky here? We got this. And management never really stepped up to the plate and said, we need him here. That's what ticked him off more than anything. You know, I'm going to say he makes a big mistake. He's only got 2 periods. He's tired, and everybody thinks he's done the right thing. But it's like Guy Lafleur. I remember I went to Buffalo. I went to Buffalo to see Guy Lafleur, his first game with the day he retired, and Jacques Lemaire benched him and embarrassed him. He was so mad he quit during the season. He regretted it ever since. Now, he's got 2 periods in the dressing room. When he comes back in the dressing room next year, he'll never go. You know why? Because you feel like a floater.
Phil
Esposito. He will not go in rooms because you feel like a floater. And you know why? It's a sad, sad thing when you see a guy like that. He's got lots of gas left in the tank and everything. And I think he's made a big mistake. He's left no window to come back right now because he said that's it. And you know, I saw him in Ottawa and I saw him there. He was nowhere to go. It was sad to see him go because he could still play, and I think he's made a big mistake.
But you always were the guy who said, I love that Bobby Orr, even though you were heartbroken, he got injured and had to quit that way. You were happy that we thought of Bobby Orr as the
yes.
of his game. And Wayne said, if I'm expected to score 120 points and I got 60, he's got 61
yeah.
this year, then he's not going to
yeah, but he got 100.
Too much pride.
He got 100 points back then. Now his team got 216 goals. 60 points here is like 120 there. I'm just saying, I think he made a mistake. You should listen to the wife. The wife said he should have played another year. I think he should have played a year. That's my opinion.
And it's a good one. And I don't think there's any question. It's a public relations fiasco in New York for Neil. I don't know how he's going to climb out of it if they have a tough year again, and they ought to have a tough year. And the other thing, Don, do you think he was ever properly paid?
Well, I think he was properly paid. He's got enough dough.
He's such a good guy. I always thought he just...
You know when he'll start here? You know when he'll really... Well, $6 million and $7
million. I know, but he's worth... You telling me that he's not worth twice as much as anybody else in the National Hockey
League? Makes another 10. What, how much money do you have to make? You know when he's really going to hear it? When he's feel it? There's 3 weeks to go before training camp. It's all right now. He's happy and everything. It'll be a knife in the heart. I'm telling you, you made a big mistake retiring. Of course, that's me. I'm just saying, I'm the only guy who seems to say it anyhow, and I'll probably be wrong. But I know we got to go. I just got to get something off my chest. I watched Pat Quinn and Robbie Fatorik. I was watching the game. And if we could just roll it, I know we don't have much time. A little lesson for you coaches out there. Never run up scores on teams. Watch Fatorik. That was the 7th goal. He's not happy. Change the lines right here. Now watch this. It goes over the bench. He's not happy running up the score in Montreal. Let's go. Now watch Pat Quinn coming up. I think they got...
I hate to argue, but I might as well. If he doesn't want him to run up the score, what's he doing with Eliash, Arnett, and Sikora, his hottest line on the ice?
All right, now watch Pat Quinn coming right up here. When they get their 7th goal, I think, or 8th goal or something like that, he's on the bench. He's not happy either. You know why? You embarrass the other team. There's Sundin. He never got on the ice for the last 10 minutes because he kept him on the bench. Now, what I'm going to say is, not like a certain team that beat my team 15-0. And two years ago, they were up 3-1, and they choked. And I said when they beat us 3-0, they had no character. They'll get up again 3-1, and Oshawa beat them. They were up 3-1, and they lost again.
They'd lose their number one goalie.
And the other guy played pretty good, too. Doesn't matter.
Well, I know.
I'm just telling you coaches out there, don't run up scores on team. It's not the Canadian way. And it's a funny thing. When you see Oshawa, they fight back. And, you know, I remember the 15th goal. They were giving it this one and laughing on our benches like that. It always comes back to haunt you. And all you do, coaches out there, you make bitter enemies like I'm bitter right now. I can hardly wait till next year. Play it smart. That's why the Boston Bruins had 11-20 over 20 goal scores, because when we get up a big score, the third and fourth line always played. Don't be, I like to say something right now, don't run up scores and be a jerk.
No, you're 100% right on that. Don Cherry wishes we get a little more of the great one, the grapes one, on Hockey Night in Canada.
Coach's Corner on CBC. Brought to you by Canadian Airlines. Recognizing the value of teamwork.
Antiques are a great...
He was so thick at New Jersey, having a lousy team, he didn't want to run up the score. Sakic for Colorado in a battle that could be somewhat a playoff preview. That makes it 1-0 there. Atchanom has scored for the St. Louis Blues, the hottest team in the West right now, leads the Los Angeles Kings after 20 minutes. And Washington Buffalo is a 6-ET start. You're up to the minute on the final day of the NHL regular season.
Why do so many people...
Missed about seven games. You've been in the room, though, Peter. What's the mood like today?
Oh, yes, it's a special day for Wayne and for everybody that is part of our team. So it's been so far a very, very happy room, very upbeat.
Is brought to you by Chevrolet, who salutes Wayne Gretzky and all he has brought to the game.
Around, kept in by Barber at the right point. That was off Bart's shoulder. In the corner, fired it in front. Here is an empty net chance for Gretzky with 5 seconds. He's moving in. Score! They're mauling Gretzky over in the corner. The fans go...
You buy Chevrolet. Chevrolet. Tried, tested, and true.
Good shape. A beautiful goal for Wayne when he was 6 years old. Says it's the only time he was ever overmatched. He started in novice AAA with 11-year-olds and scored one goal. By the time he was 11, he had 378. And we all know when he became the kid in the NHL, from there on in, nobody could match him.
Here is an empty net chance for Gretzky with 5 seconds. He's moving in. Score! 50 goals in 39 games. Gretzky shoots. Score! Now here the Calgary Gretzky going to break in a goal. Can he score?
One thing that I will do is that when I'm not doing the best I can, and when I'm not making people happy in the stands, I'll retire. I don't think that if I'm expected to score 60 goals and 60 assists a year, that I'll stick around to play with 30 goals and 30 assists. I just won't. And maybe I'll be finished before they can start saying that so and so is better.
I expected to probably play professional hockey till 30 or 31, and that's probably as far as I thought I would play. But I can also say that I used to always think in my mind, what is going to give me the high or the fun and the energy? What is going to replace hockey? And I still haven't found that.
Oilers win the draw. Kevin Lowe off the glass, kept in by Duchesne, a rolling puck.
I think this is the very first time I started skating because that was in the river, my grandmother's house, and that of course is in her living room there as I'm, you know, playing hockey against my grandmother. I think the first time I actually skated, I was 2.5 years old. I can't tell you how many hours I spent. I mean, I tell my boys now, I'll say, you know, when I was your age, I would skate 7-8 hours a day. And they're like, oh, Daddy, you didn't skate that much. And I don't know why. I don't know what possessed me to do that. It wasn't like somebody saying, oh, you better get out there and skate. You better get out there and practice. My life, that's what I enjoyed doing.
I get upset at him because we're very different in personalities, in a sense where he can sit back and, like, take so much from all directions, and I can't. I'm like his dad. He's a little more fiery about things. Your mom contains herself very well and with a lot of poise. So I think that that's Wayne takes a lot after his mom.
Konstantinov wants to skate out. Gretzky stopped it. He had to wait for a hole. He was slow coming back. Now he's going to get a shot. Gretzky scores! Hole to Gretzky.
What do you hate the most about hockey? I would say the winning and losing, because when you win, we were groomed and taught that there's nothing other than winning. So you learn that winning becomes everything. And when you lose, it's gut-wrenching. And to this day, you know, I'll go home after a loss and you lie in bed till 3-4 in the morning and think about what happened and wonder why you lost and what went wrong and what you could have done. And I probably, at this point in my life, it hurts me more to lose now than I did when I was 24 years old.
Linden is pressured. Gretzky in front. Saved by Flaherty. The rebound. Score! Number 1072 for Wayne Gretzky. All time.
I often tell people, I don't know why I have it or why I was chosen. I have no other... I don't know why I love it so much. I mean, sometimes I say, geez, you know, this has been my life. I love it. And sometimes I often wonder why I was chosen.
He's a great guy, a fabulous hockey player. He's just something else for this game of hockey. Wayne Gretzky.
On the ice, the only image I try to show the kids is, you know, the go out there and do the best you can and work hard all the time. What I do out there, I've been doing since I was 2 years old, and it just doesn't come overnight. But if there's an image, that would be it on the ice. And you know, off the ice, I'd like to keep an image that kids would look up to and say, you know, geez, I'd like to be like him.
Asked me the other day, and I wouldn't trade my life in for anything. I'm like everyone else. I mean, I have bad days and I have down days and I have days that aren't as good as other days, but all in all, I wouldn't trade it in for the world. I've got a great family and I came from really good parents, and no, I'm always happy to be Wayne Gretzky.
Has wealth changed you?
No, not at all.
Why not? It would change me.
Because I think my parents taught me to respect people and respect life. You know, I never belittle people and I never put people down. I don't believe in that. I believe we're all equal. I'm very fortunate. Hey, listen, I'm the first guy to say I'm very fortunate that I do have money. But, you know, I grew up, I didn't have money. I think it's probably one of the hardest things about being a parent with money, to trying to teach your kids not to be spoiled and to be polite and be good to other people. But probably the biggest reason why it hasn't changed me is my dad hasn't allowed me to change, and I think that's the biggest reason.
I think you've been a little down lately. So, well, I got you something. And I think we're both going to notice a big difference. But you have to be happy, so we'll just try it out for a bit. And if we don't like it, it's no big deal.
Try Star Choice for a month before you commit. It's risk-free. Either you love it or you bring it back and don't pay a thing for your system or installation. Nothing. Star Choice. It's your television.
See, you look better already.
The exhilarating vapor blast of new Max Air.
This is Max Air, target confirmed. Max Air, lock on target.
Makes it taste different from other gums.
Max Air, lock on.
Results may vary. The exhilarating vapor blast of new Max Air makes it taste different from other gums. Wayne's ultimate bearing.
I feel good.
Right now, for a limited time, the Nissan Enjoy the Savings event is rocking on. With great lease deals, special finance rates, and big savings. Check out all the exciting details in your newspaper.
Wow! I feel good!
Then get down to your Nissan dealership and feel good.
Hey. Matt, got your email. Vancouver? Genius. Passed it on to Epps. He's running it through the Northwest.
Hey, Matt. Ideas are hitting the Northwest. I've got purchasing checking suppliers.
You want it up top. Client briefing. Your Vancouver idea.
Want to take your business to the next level? Electronic commerce from AT&T Canada.
Do you actually know how long you're going to play?
Probably have a feel or an understanding.
A conversation with the great one.
I'd love to win one more championship.
Zoski in conversation with Wayne Gretzky. Monday at 9 on CBC.
An historic day for the National Hockey League. Wayne Gretzky's farewell here at Madison Square Garden. It's Pittsburgh, New York, tied at 1 at the end of two periods of play. Janet Jones Gretzky is sitting in the studio, and we'll get thoughts from Wayne here in just a moment. Look at that. I wish I could have one of those. That'd be good, Tim. Thank you.
These are the Schmitz of Munich. This is their new Porsche Boxster. In order to drive it...
Unbelievable day, and everyone's happy for Wayne, happy for you. I guess the obvious question is, how are you feeling?
Well, it's a little surreal today. I mean, it's been a lot of emotions all week. Well, for me...
Hi.
Surface here in New York today, and the crowd stands and salutes 99 one more time.
The best player on any ice surface in any rink at any time.
Australia.
Go back, come on. Yeah. Go back, come on.
He is about to remove those skates for the last time in a terrific, illustrious career.
Thank you.
swing.
As you see, that did skate around, and I don't believe a soul has left this building. They're all standing. Caught my ear. Frank Sinatra, The Last Dance. And folks, you just saw The Last Dance.
Big banks will change when chipmunks play harmonica.
Hey, current ones too. Our tribute at Fox for the great one.
Nobody does it better. Makes me feel safe.
The feelings being on the ice, the feelings of the thunderous ovations. What do you feel?
Unions, make the call of the wild.
I'm disappointed it's over. Obviously, I love the game so much, and said repeatedly, I loved playing and living in New York. And, you know, it's just, it's a great game, and treated me with to a lot of great things, and I'm going to miss it dearly.
What was the greatest feeling during the course of the afternoon that you had on the ice?
Just that in my heart, I knew I was making the right decision. And the other side of it, I knew I still loved the game so much, but I knew it was the right decision.
On behalf of Fox TV, which has done coverage for the last 5 years, on behalf of fans, on behalf of all of us, for John Davidson, for Mike Emmerich, we loved watching you. Thank you for all the thrills that you provided.
All right, you guys are great to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Wayne. Best of luck. Well, that's it. A special day here at Madison Square Garden as Wayne Gretzky has played his last game. Thank you for our coverage in New York. So long, everyone.
Makes me feel safe for the rest.
This has been a presentation.
That must be a big day.
That's
Paul
a big
Roman,
day.
Paul Roman live at Madison Square Garden.
Popped up a bunker shot.
News conference as soon. He's going to take off the last sweater he wore. He'll autograph all the things he used and wore today. And as you heard earlier, and over the last couple of days, some of these things will go to the Hall of Fame. Some will go to charity. Some will go to friends. And so Gretzky, who has always dotted the I's and crossed the T's when it comes to things like that, will take care of that business. First of all, though, some perspective on what has happened here. A week ago, we would not be discussing this. Likely, it has really gained momentum over the last week or so. Here now, a look at the last week that was for Wayne Gretzky in the NHL.
And there's a Nokia.
Monday, the speculation was rampant that Gretzky would announce his retirement soon. That night, he set up the game-winning goal in the Rangers' 2-1 victory over the Tampa Bay Lightning. He wouldn't comment after the game that night, but on Tuesday morning, the New York Post reported that Gretzky would indeed announce his retirement later in the week.
Well, in the first place, I wouldn't have gone with the story unless I knew it was accurate. There's no question that Gretzky will retire on Sunday, following Sunday's game. There are various reasons. Wayne hasn't confirmed the retirement yet. He will address the issues.
He was talking on Tuesday, but not about retirement. Honoring an earlier commitment, Gretzky talked about his participation
with Chalet's Caribbean
Summit, designed to talk about where the game is.
In 79, the first time Wayne Gretzky was on Hockey Night in Canada, Bobby Orr was the analyst that night, and here it is, April 18th, 1999. There's John Muckler, and I can't get it out of my head. I'd love to sit and talk about New York because they gave you a beautiful tribute. Well, let's let you give us a sense of how you're feeling right at the moment.
Well, I'm disappointed. It's over. And, I know it's the right time. And I could honestly say I'm leaving a game that I love. I wish I could play a lot longer. I wish we could keep going. Reality is I'm probably smarter than I was 20 years ago, but I know I'm not as good as I was 20 years ago or even 10 years ago. But the one thing I tried to do, and I tried to show our young guys in New York, is that, you know, I never asked for any favors. You know, I came to practice every day. I practiced hard. And I played hard every night. Some games I played bad, some games I didn't. But, you know, I know in my heart I prepared every single game as hard as I could. And it's the right time. I'm devastated. I'm leaving the game. I love it, but it's the right time.
Wayne, you've gone through pretty much all the issues, and I would like to get on to some of the nice moments, because there's a lot of them for a lot of fans, especially up in Edmonton. But I do have to ask you that sense that if there'd have been more done to help you, support you here in New York, that things would have been different. Is that a little bit of maybe bitterness or desperation in your decision that you hope doesn't, you know, rise up in August?
No, not at all, because I talked with a couple hockey players, a couple guys I'm good friends with, and we chatted about the game itself. And I kept coming back to the same issue, that whether I was playing with Jaromír Jágr or Lindros or Theon Fleury, guys I really respect and really think are great players, I wouldn't have changed my mind. I'd still be not coming back. This organization has treated me tremendously. I have nothing but great things to say about it. It's just time. I don't think it would have been any different if I had been on number one team in hockey. I just physically and mentally, I could feel in my heart it was getting to a point where I needed to make a change.
All right, let's go back in time a little bit and start with him, because I had the sense that Ottawa, that was really a magical night at the press conference, at the game. That was Canada's crown prince, no question. So, I mean, but the Edmonton scene, that first goal in Game 4 in 84, where do you want to pick it up? Maybe it's Ron Lowe, the trade to get him, and that great series with Philadelphia. Let's start there, and just making it to the Stanley Cup playoffs, making it in the NHL.
I think that I had so many fond memories, and I'm like every other kid was. The first game I played in the NHL, we played in the old Chicago Stadium. I played against Stan Mikita, Tony Esposito, people that I grew up collecting their hockey cards and idolizing. And here we are in the Chicago Stadium. My dad and a friend took a train to Chicago to be able to go to the game. I thought that this was something that was right out of a movie. I couldn't believe that I was in the National Hockey League. And that was my first great memory, and playing in that building. I'll never forget it.
It's funny. Glenn Sather said he saw you score two goals in Indianapolis, and then he made the trade for Eddie, Peter, and yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, he actually thought that was, of all the things, he picked that out, which... I mean, people disregard that one year in Indianapolis and maybe the pressures you went through there.
Well, I was a young, skinny kid, and, you know, I was telling somebody today earlier, at 17 years old, when Bobby Orr came in, everyone knew that he was going to dominate the National Hockey League. When I was 17 years old, people still questioned my size and my speed and everything that kind of went with that strength, and I kind of grew into it. And I think that I'm very proud. I worked hard. I'm very proud that, as I said, I respected all my coaches that I had, whether it be in the NHL or Team Canada's or the Olympic team. Everyone was always good to me, and I know that I was good to them.
Yeah, you sure were. When you talked to Janet, I know one of my favorite memories of the trade in 88 is how you said you couldn't. Janet says, call Mark. Let Mark know. And he said, I can't call Mark, because if I call Mark, I won't go.
Yeah.
He'll talk me into staying in Edmonton. So.
Well, he was the only guy at the time that I knew could talk me out of it. We had a special relationship, a unique relationship, and maybe unlike any other in sports, because you had two guys that had a lot of publicity, and yet neither one of us really ever had a negative thought or negative thing to say about the other guy. We just always hoped they would get more and hoped they'd win more. And I think that that between the two of us really went through the whole hockey team, and it started at the top, obviously with Glenn Sather, and that time we had a defenseman by the name of Lee Fogelman, who was the captain, that really, I've said this many times before, he was the heart and soul of the Oilers early on, and he was the guy that showed myself and Messier and guys like that what it was like to play hurt, what it was like to play hard, and what it was like to practice.
Give us a sense of the pressures after you go to Los Angeles. That's the first time you said, I think, to me one time that, you know, I wanted so badly to play for Bruce, I was almost paralyzed. That's the first time I felt like I wanted it so badly for somebody that I wasn't myself. You sure weren't first year you got by Edmonton and you took them to a Stanley Cup, so you obviously had great successes there too. But.
Well, we worked really hard at a lot of different things. It wasn't to go there. I knew I had to put in a full 24 hours a day. And the whole organization did. Everyone worked hard, all my teammates. And I really enjoyed LA. It was a real neat experience. I mean, it's different. You're playing in Edmonton and Toronto and Montreal, and that's hockey. I mean, people live and die it. We grew up with it. We breed it. It's our life, and that's what it's all about. And all of a sudden, here I was in this town that people really didn't know what hockey was or who was in the league or what it was all about. And we worked hard at selling it. And now you have Anaheim and LA and Phoenix and San Jose. So I like to think we worked hard and we came a long way.
How come you settled? Bruce said you'll be the highest paid player, and you were happy. Let's be honest. He treated you as best he could with all that was going on and so forth. But you never really did make double the money. I know you said a beautiful thing yesterday. For every kid, that's the most important lesson of all, to play for the passion, the money will come. Did you ever feel like you were taken advantage of? You wouldn't say it. I don't know why I'd even ask it. Yeah. But did you ever have that sense that maybe I wasn't appreciated in that regard?
No, I never felt that way. I felt like I was treated very good. I thought I was treated tremendously. But I was 29 years old, and I was making pretty good money. And yet, I knew there was a limitation to what a team could spend, and I felt it was much more imperative that I had a chance to build a team around me and build a championship team than to make double the money. And I felt like if we were winning and we were successful, that stuff would kind of fall into place and that stuff would take care of itself later on. And for me, it was more important to go out and get guys like Thomas Sandstrom and Marty McSorley and Kelly Rudy, guys like that were going to make us a better team. And that's why I never begrudged what I made there.
All right, a couple of your close pals here today. Mark Messier really shook up, and I think this was a neat, for the two of you, have been through a ton in the last 2 years, let's be honest.
Well, I called him on Thursday to tell him I wanted him to know from me, and we're all shook up. I got a chance to talk to Mark, and that really, it's hard. It's you know, we grew up as kids. We threw the puck on the pond, and we chased it around, and you know, I never grew up collecting hockey cards to sell them. I grew up collecting hockey cards because I wanted to take them and put them in my binder at school and show them off and things like that. I love the game, and I love the fact that the Canadian people are so proud of our game, and I'm very proud of it too. And you know, now I got to enter the new phase. I got new directions now. I got kids to worry about. I got a practice that I don't have to worry about tomorrow, but everything else, I got a future ahead of me now that I got a lot of things to do.
How long did Michael Jordan talk to you about the heartbreak of not going to the court or the rink? Is the case?
Well, conversation today, and he just said that you know, it's I understand what you're saying at your press conference. I can relate to where you're coming from, and he said the same. Basically, he felt the same way, that it was a gut feel and it was time. And you know, Janet said to him today, she fought it to the 11th hour for the last 4 days. She didn't make it easy on me, but she knows how much I love the game, and she was just basically playing devil's advocate. Pulled her into the room the other day before I went to Ottawa, and I said, you know, it's really important for me that this is a celebration, that I'm not passing on, I'm moving on, and that if you rally around this, then my dad will and everybody else will, and that's what happened.
I see Orr and Howe and Beliveau, and they're having happy lives.
Yeah.
I think a lot of us felt that the only, because it does feel right, but the only time sometimes